morning, Chandler.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure and a joy to see your beautiful faces on this beautiful Sunday morning. A few announcements before we begin. I'd like to remind you that we are still taking pictures for the directory. If you haven't had your picture taken yet, please see Faye or Joyce after service today to have that done. And I'm happy to announce that the bell choir is starting up again. So please look in your bulletins and get in touch with Madeline if you want to make beautiful music on the bells this year. A note that did not get into the bulletin is that we are having consistory tomorrow. So elders, deacons, please have that on your calendar, and everyone else, please pray for us that we'll have wisdom and knowledge to make the right choices for our church. And for all the other announcements, please consult your bulletin. However, I have heard from a little bird that Allison Gumming, who plays piano for us on occasion, has had her baby last week, a little girl. That's all I know right now, but let's be thankful that another life has entered into the world.
When's the young one's baptism?
Oh, that is a good question. I don't know. With that, brothers and sisters, may the grace of the Father and the fellowship of the Son and the love of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our call to worship today is from Psalm 119. Your word, O Lord, is eternal. It stands firm in the heavens. Your faithfulness continues through all generations. You establish the earth and it endures. Your law endures to this day, for all things serve you. If your law had not been my delight, I would have perished in my affliction. I will not forget your precepts, for by them you have preserved my life. Save me, for I am yours. I have sought out your precepts. The wicked are waiting to destroy me, but I will ponder your statutes. To all creation I see a limit, but your commands are boundless. Let us join together in worshiping this God, whose power is boundless and his love has no limits. Will you please rise and sing number 87, Fairest Lord Jesus, verses 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you.
brothers and sisters, the peace of Christ be with you all. As God has welcomed you here today, please turn to your neighbor and welcome them. Please join me in a confession of faith as we say together the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Just as we make a confession of our faith, we know that we can go before our Lord and make a confession of our sins, fully confident that we are already forgiven. Will you please join me in prayer? Have mercy upon us, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercies. Blot out our transgressions. Wash us thoroughly from our sin and cleanse us from our iniquities. For we know our transgressions, and our sin is ever before us. Create in us a clean heart, and put a new and right spirit within us. Cast us not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from us. Restore to us the joy of your salvation, and uphold us with the willing spirit. We pray this together through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, he who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give you life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. And all God's children say, Amen. As a hymn of thanks and praise, let us rise and sing number 339, His Grace. this time, I invite our deacons to come forward and lead us in the giving of our gifts.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this beautiful Sunday morning to thank and praise and honor you for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Be with us this week, Lord. Guide our footsteps. We pray for the farmers who will once again be in the field. Grant them special mercies as they bring in the harvest. We also ask a special merciful blessing unto those who cannot be here with us this day, that if they are ill, you may stretch your hand over them and heal them from what has caused their illness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just as we bring our physical gifts to the Lord, let us also bring our prayers to Him as well. Will you please join me in prayers for you? Holy God, Lord of heaven and earth, I thank you for this day that you have made, with all its glory and beauty. I thank you today that on this day we can come and celebrate your Holy Communion. I thank you that you have washed us clean by the blood of Jesus. And that you, Jesus, are the living water that makes us streams of living water. I thank you that you've given us your body and your blood so that we can eat the bread of heaven and drink that wonderful wine. I pray, Lord, that your gifts to us will continue to grow and produce fruit in our lives, so that no matter where we are or what we're doing, we may always shine your light in this world. And I thank you, Lord, that you raise up men and women to go out to every corner of this world to carry your word. We pray for the Bruxfords and the Hubers and the Ward Silvas as they continue to do their missionary work. I pray that you will bless their faithfulness, and that through their work, Lord, your kingdom will come. I thank you, Lord, that you also provide us with farmers and equipment that they need to bring in a harvest. I thank you, Lord, that you've been with them up to this point, and pray that you continue to protect and guide as they continue to bring in your crop. I pray that this will be a blessed crop that will provide for their needs in the coming year, as well as provide what is necessary food for the people of the world. I pray also that you'll continue to give healing to those who are sick and injured. Continue to pray for those who are sick with coronavirus, Lord. We provide healing and protect us. We also pray for those who have cancer and all other forms of diseases, Lord. May your healing hand rest upon them. We also remember those who can't be with us here today, whether at Edgebrook or at home, or whether they're traveling in the world, Lord. Our hearts are with them. We love our family very much. And we know, Lord, that your love for them is even more perfect and greater than our own. So we ask that you will hold our family in your hands. We also love our country, Lord, and we do our best to be good and faithful citizens. So I pray that you will be with our leaders. You give them wisdom. You give them the strength to do what is right. And when, Lord, our leaders can't agree, I pray that your spirit will bring peace, for you are the Prince of Peace. And until that day you return, Lord, teach us all to be faithful and patient and calm and wise, so that in the face of the madness and evil in this world, your kingdom will reign triumphant. Lord, I thank you that our schools continue to be open, our children continue to learn, and our teachers continue to teach. May these schools, Lord, be blessed by your hand, whether it's at Edgerton or in Slayton or around the world, Lord. Bless the schools so that the next generation may grow straight and true and will be able to do the work that you provided for. I also thank you for those who have gone before us, who are enjoying their retirement years. I pray, Lord, that your hand will continue to uphold them and strengthen them. May they have the joy of life that you have given them, so that even though they might be retired from their earthly work, Lord, they can still continue to do your heavenly work, showing us younger generations how it's done. So that in all ways and in all things, Lord, we can always give the glory and praise to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us conclude our time of prayer by singing our doxology. Our scripture reading today is Ecclesiastes chapter 11. For those of you who are new to this sermon series, I just want to remind everyone once again that in Hebrew, what gets translated as meaningless actually means a cloud, This is especially important in chapter 11, where we have different kinds of clouds in this chapter. So as we go through our reading, when I come to the word meaningless, I will translate that as cloud, however. And the clouds in chapter 11 that we read in the English text are a specific kind of cloud. They're a rain cloud, often associated with a thunder cloud. So when we get to those clouds, I will say a storm cloud, to help us better see what Solomon is talking about here. Ecclesiastes chapter 11. Cast your bread upon the waters, for after many days you will find it again. Give portions to seven, yes, to eight, for you do not know what disaster may come upon the land. If storm clouds are full of water, they pour rain upon the earth. Whether a tree falls to the south or to the north, in the place where it falls, there will it lie. Whoever watches the wind will not plant, whoever looks at the storm clouds will not reap. As you do not know the path of the wind or how the body is formed in a mother's womb, so you cannot understand the work of God, the maker of all things. Sow your seed in the morning, and at evening let not your hands be idle, for you do not know which will succeed, whether this or that, or whether both will do equally well. Light is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. However many years a man may live, let him enjoy them all, but let him remember the days of darkness, for they will be many. Everything to come is a cloud. Be happy, young man, while you are young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. Follow the ways of your heart and whatever your eyes see. But know that all of these things God will bring you to judgment. So then, banish anxiety from your heart and cast off the troubles of your body, for youth and vigor are clouds. This is the word of the Lord. The fear of missing out, also known as FOMO, is the anxiety that comes from the feeling that we are not enjoying life as much as we could. It is the fear that somebody, somewhere, is having fun without us. It could be from a big event that we're missing, possibly a wedding or a birthday party, or it might come from something small, like eating hamburgers or gardening. It doesn't matter how important or how small the event is, the anxiety doesn't care. The point is that we are missing out on something. The fear of missing out is often associated with excessive use of social media, scrolling through your Facebook feed or constantly checking your Twitter account or doing whatever the latest craze happens to be. Of course, there's nothing wrong in and of itself. There's nothing wrong with checking out the pictures your second cousin posted of their weekend trip to Wisconsin. However, when this comes at the expense of ignoring the people who are with you, this is a problem. The irony is that trying to stay up to date on everything that is happening in the world often causes us to miss out on what is happening in our own lives. This is especially harmful when it is a parent who ignores their children. Of course, social media is not the only cause of FOMO. Other examples include spending too much time keeping up on sports, watching the news too much, listening to talk shows, or going on shopping sprees every weekend. In and of themselves, none of these are bad, but when we do it out of fear of missing out on something, that is when they become a problem. Whatever causes you to fear that you are missing out on life, that is your FOMO. Not surprisingly, advertisers like to use this anxiety in an effort to get you to buy more things. But Solomon would say that acting out of a fear of missing out on life is a chasing after the wind. It is as meaningless and pointless as trying to hold on to a cloud. The world's answer is that we should buy more things and consume more stuff. But Solomon's answer is that we should fear God and keep his commands. We shouldn't fear missing out on the things of this world. Rather, we should fear missing out on the things of heaven. The good news is that the more we fear missing out on the things of heaven, the more we actually enjoy the things of this world. But to better understand that, let us take another look at Ecclesiastes chapter 11. As I mentioned last week, chapters 10 and 11 are probably the most difficult chapters to interpret in the book of Ecclesiastes. Last week, we read advice from Solomon on how we're supposed to deal with evil leaders, leaders who are angry or just plain incompetent. Trouble was is that his advice didn't really make sense and kind of contradicted a lot of what we read earlier. So we use the principle that the words we use to worship God is how we come to know God better and understand our place in the world that God has made. And so we use Psalm 45 as a kind of reading glasses to help us more clearly see what we are reading. Psalm 45 was a wedding psalm, a wedding psalm. And so when we remember that we belong to God, that God is our protector and provider, our husband, and that we are the bride of Christ, then we have the assurance and the strength to remain calm and act wisely and to speak gracious words when faced with the evil and the madness that the world has to offer. We will use a similar strategy this week in interpreting chapter 11. This week we are using Psalm 65. Psalm 65 is a psalm of praise, where the psalmist gives praise to God because God is a God who answers prayers, forgives sins, and provides for the people of the world. Two important verses in this psalm is verse 7 and verse 9. In verse 7, we read that God stilled the roaring of the seas, the roaring of the waves, and the turmoil of the nations. What's important from this verse is that the people of the world are equated with the waters of the seas. And then in verse 9, the psalmist declares that the streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with rain, for so you have ordained it. What's important about this verse is that it is God's will that water provide rain for the people of the world. So with that in mind, let us look at verse 1 of chapter 11. Cast your bread upon the waters, for after many days you will find it again. This is a very confusing verse, and there's many different ways to interpret it. Scholars debate back and forth one way or the other. Now, it actually sounds a lot like one of the Proverbs, which says, ship your grain across the seas, or you may get a return for it. They're similar, but they're different. The proverb says to go out and do things because they may give you a return. You might earn a profit. But in verse 1, there is no guarantee of a profit. We send our grain on the waters, and then it returns to us. There is no return. There's no greater yield. What we give out is what we receive. So as a proverb, this doesn't quite make sense. And so, let's dig a little deeper. Remembering what we read from Psalm 65, we can equate waters with the nations and all the people of the world. A literal translation of verse 1 would be something like, send your grain to the face of the waters, for after many days it will be revealed to you again. This is a bit clunky, but it is a poetic way of saying, share your food with the people of the world. Your food, of course, is for the you eat by putting food into your face. So give your food to the people so that they may eat it. And if they're eating it, you're not going to get a return. But your kindness that you give out is the kindness that will come back to you. Now don't think of this as some kind of works righteousness or karma, what comes around goes around, for we don't know when our day of disaster is going to happen. So yes, give portions to 7 and 8. Be generous, abundantly generous to the world, and maybe on the day of disaster they will be there to help you, but maybe not. If you die, it doesn't matter how generous you were to other people, they can't help you anymore. So, why should we be generous? If this isn't building up some sort of works righteousness or building up karma, why do we do it? Well, because it is the will of God. God has ordained that his waters provide grain for the people of the world. When we are providing food for the people of the world, we are acting in accordance with God's will. You could even say that we become streams of living water. Not that we're doing this out of our own strength, but rather we are joining together in the work that God is already doing. When we remember that God has provided us with our own bread, then it's not really giving our bread to the world, but rather we are sharing the bread that God has given us with the world. We are participating in the great work that God is doing. And if we're participating in the great work that God is doing, if we remember that God is faithful today and tomorrow, then it will be much easier for us to open our hands and give. Even on the day of disaster, we know that God is faithful and will continue to provide. In our life and in our death, our only comfort is our faithful Lord, Jesus Christ. And this is the message that Solomon continues to teach in the following verses. Rain falls from clouds and trees fall to the ground. Who knows where the rain will land and who knows which direction the tree will point in? The point is that the wind is the one who blows them all. It is the wind that knows where it's coming from and where it's going. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Often the things that look good today turn out to be bad from the future point of view. So, the only wise thing for us to do is to do what God wills for us to do, to fear him and follow his commands. Probably the greatest example of this is the crucifixion itself. On the day that Jesus was crucified and died, to all appearances, this was a great defeat. It is a great evil. And yet, in all of history, there is nothing more victorious, more glorious, than the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. And so, since we can't always tell the difference between what is evil and what is good, we should always worship God and follow his commands. Indeed, when Jesus has gone up to heaven, from an earthly point of view, that doesn't make much sense. How much better would our witness be if Jesus were to come back to earth and walk around? We could point to him and say, see, there he is, his flesh and blood. That makes sense to us. But that is not in accordance with God's will. And so instead of trying to out-guess or out-think God, we should just settle down, relax, fear God, worship God, and follow his commands. For the more we rest in God's presence, the more we experience God's comfort, the more our love for God grows. And when we feel God's presence, of course, our love and our gratitude for God grows as well. We want to please God. For Jesus is our husband, our provider. We want to walk with him and do the work that he is doing. And so we go out into the world, sharing the bread of Jesus with the world, not because of our strength, but because of our love and gratitude for what Jesus has done for us. And so we sow our seeds in the morning, and we let not our hands get idle in the evening time. Hold this thought of constantly working with what we said last week about celebrating, of enjoying our food and our wine. Our work and our celebration becomes one in God. When we're celebrating our wedding feast, we worship God. When we're out in the fields working, we worship God. When we are at home, cleaning house or cooking dinner or maybe changing the diaper of a child or grandchild, worship God. For it is all a beautiful wedding feast, and it is all the work that God has given us. And since we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, do it with a joyful heart. Do it in service to what God has done in our lives. And then verse 7 is another complicated verse to understand. Light is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. Having light around is better than being in darkness, but looking at the sun is not sweet. It burns our eyes. And throughout the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon has complained that the work that happens under the sun is toilsome and burdensome. And he also sees much evil done under the sun. So what is happening here? Well, first off, I see that Solomon's complaints at the beginning of Ecclesiastes are turning into a hymn of praise to God. Yes, there is evil in the world, but God still shines his light upon the world. The good things that are in the world can't be enjoyed in darkness. We can't enjoy them when we're dead. But God gives us light. Because of the light of God, we can enjoy the good things of this world. We can enjoy them in the years of our life. So while, yes, there is madness and chaos and evil in the world, we can still see the good things that God is doing, not by our own wisdom, but by the light that God shines in the world. And these things that are evil and mad and crazy and contrary to God's will, why, they're just clouds that are passing away. Praise God, the evil day won't last forever. There is hope for tomorrow. Since there's hope for tomorrow, be happy, young man. Remember, we are coming at Ecclesiastes as if we're going to a very old King Solomon who is sitting on his deathbed giving us his last words. We are all young men compared to this Solomon. So as long as we have breath to breathe, as long as we have days of life to live, let us live them as young men and women, with our hearts full of joy, for these are the days of our youth as well. Follow our hearts and do what pleases our eyes, for that is what God has given us to do. But remember that God's judgment is also coming. This might seem like bad news, but it is good news, because while we are doing what our hearts desire, we also see that there is much evil in the world. But we know that God's judgment is coming and will blow the evil days away like a cloud. What remains is God and everything that God has made. The works of evil humanity, the works of sin and Satan and death, those will come to an end. But our days in God's kingdom will last forever. With that knowledge in mind, it becomes much easier for us to banish our anxiety and to cast off the troubles of our hearts and our bodies and our minds, to live a life of vigor and youth, even in our old age. No, Solomon is not saying that we should act younger than we actually are. If your bones are getting rickety and your joints are creaking, don't go trying to do gymnastics. But that is no reason why we should stop doing God's commands. That is no reason why we should stop being joyful and singing hymns of praise to God each day that we have to live. Indeed, following God's commands are how we cast our anxiety from our heart. We are giving our bread upon the water, and in doing so, we are releasing our anxieties. We no longer fear missing out on the things of this world, because we know that God provides for our needs. The more we try to hold on to heaven, the more we enjoy the things of this world. Because the more we do God's commands, the more we see God's faithfulness. The more we grow in the assurance that I might miss out on this thing today, but tomorrow I am going to enjoy a holy day of rest with God. Today, we come together to celebrate communion. We come to receive from Jesus his bread and his cup. This is obviously made by human hands, but we come remembering what Jesus has done for us. The hands that provide for our needs are the same hands that were pierced upon the cross. Those hands continue to do their work. Death and Satan and all the evil and madness of the world cannot stop Jesus from doing his Father's will. Death could not hold him, and he is alive today, sitting on the throne of heaven. Jesus gives to us his living water and his bread of heaven. He gives us these things to sustain our lives, to comfort us in our misery and our pain. He gives us these things to grow our faith, hope, and love. He wraps us in his clothes. He fills us with his Holy Spirit. Does he do this so that we can keep it for ourselves, to hold on with two fists, to be greedy with the grace he has given us? Not at all. He gives us abundantly so that we may abundantly give. We are forgiven completely so that we can go and completely forgive. The grace that we receive from God is new every morning, so that at night we can continue to give grace to our families, our friends, and our neighbors. Brothers and sisters, come to the table that the Lord has provided for you. Remember that Jesus is your groom, and that we are his bride, and that the work we do today and tomorrow, let that work be pleasing, a pleasing aroma to the Lord. And may God be glorified in all that we do and say. As a hymn of response, will you please join me in singing number 409, Thanks to God Whose Word Was Spoken. Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us join together in a prayer of thanks and praise to God. With joy we praise you, gracious God, for you have created heaven and earth. You have made us in your image and keep covenant with us, even when we fall into sin. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, who came among us as the Word made flesh to show us your glory, full of grace and truth. Therefore, we join our voices with all the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. And we say together, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Jesus Christ, send your Holy Spirit to be with us. We pray that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Grant that, being joined together in him, we may attain the unity of the faith and grow up in all things into Christ our Lord. And as this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, and these grapes have been gathered from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Will the elders please come forward? The Lord Jesus, on the same night when he was betrayed, took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, in remembrance of me. This is my body, broken for you." The bread which we break is our participation in the body of Christ. In the same way, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." The cup of blessing which we bless is our participation in the blood of Christ. The cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks is our participation in the blood of Christ. The bread which we break is our participation in the body of Christ. And just as grain was gathered from many fields to form one loaf, we who are many are gathered together to form one body in Christ. Therefore, let everything you do this week be united in the work of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, we please rise in body or in spirit as we conclude our time of worship by singing number 748, I am His and He is Mine.
Shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn to you and give you peace.